Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the Iron Curtain podcast. We're really excited to show off our interview with Caleb Maupin in just a moment, but first we wanted to make a quick statement regarding Ahmaud Arbery, a young black man who was killed in February while jogging through his own neighborhood. Previously, there was some confusion regarding the circumstances of his death, but recently released footage has confirmed what many on the left had already suspected and were unfortunately not surprised to discover. This was nothing short of cold-blooded murder, motivated by obvious and vicious racial bigotry on the part of the two assailants. The footage shows two men converge in trucks upon Ahmaud, who is simply jogging along and minding his own business, only to ambush and shoot him dead seconds later. When questioned about their motives for their actions, the killers claimed that they suspected of him being connected to a supposed string of burglaries in the area. The reason they centered their suspicions on a black man running through their neighborhood in broad daylight, however, is obvious to anyone with even a basic knowledge of our country's atrocious history of profiling, persecution, and systematic violence against black people. This inexcusable and blatant hate crime shows yet again how deeply ingrained white supremacy is in today's society, especially since legions of bigots have since taken to the internet to defend the killers and claim the atrocity was somehow justified. Clearly, our society is not nearly as far off from the days of lynchings and Klan rallies as we would like to believe. Our society must recognize that crimes of this nature are not merely the result of lone individual bad eggs or racists among us. We do not now know whether these bigots will be punished for this egregious and obvious crime, or whether they will be let off the hook with a slap on the wrist, as perpetrators of a similar nature have regularly received in the past. Regardless of the outcome of the trial, justice will still not be served to the millions of other black and brown peoples who every day live under the heel of oppression, exploitation, and occupation. That form of justice will only be achieved through revolutionary action against the core causes of the injustice: capitalism, imperialism, and white supremacy. We communists call for everyone on the left to unite in denouncing not only the perpetrators of this crime, but also against the more subtle yet equally sinister forms of white supremacy and chauvinism that surround us every day. These attitudes create a culture that both tacitly approves of and enables future crimes against black, Asian, indigenous, and other colonized and oppressed peoples across the country and around the world. We stand in solidarity with Ahmaud and his family in this devastating time, and we hope to do our small part to help the left rally around this tragedy in the fight for revolutionary change.
All right, welcome back to the Iron Curtain, where we bring you a class-conscious analysis of historic and current events which are pertinent to the international working class movement. If you want to help this show grow and expand, you can check out our Patreon account, which is listed in the show description. And if you want to reach out to us, you can hit up our Twitter at Iron Curtain Pod or our subreddit at r/TheIronCurtain. We'd love to chat with you. And we're also available now on Spotify and YouTube. So today we're joined by journalist and author, Mr. Caleb Maupin. How are you doing today, Caleb?
I'm great. Couldn't be better.
Awesome. Awesome. Now, Caleb, he's been taking his time recently to reach out to other leftist channels on YouTube, and he's been having some discussions. So we're glad to see he's willing to have a discussion here in our humble up and coming podcast. So from the Iron Curtain crew, my name is FBK. We're also joined by Comrade Denki Kang and Comrade Tactical Spork.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Yeah, so we have a list of questions here for Caleb today that we prepared. I'll pass it over to Comrade Tactical Spork for the first question.
All right, great. So yeah, Caleb, thank you so much for coming on. Just echoing what everybody said. It's really awesome having, you know, someone bigger and more established come onto the podcast, especially as our first guest that we have going on. So so we're going to alternate with questions, but my first question here is, one of the concepts that you talk about a lot in your videos and in your writing is you talk a lot about China and you talk about socialism with Chinese characteristics, but you also kind of pivot that to talk about socialism with American characteristics. That's one of the things I think you talk about a good amount. Kind of just leaving this as an open-ended question, what exactly does socialism with American characteristics mean to you? How do you maybe visualize that? Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because I got interested in socialism growing up. I lived in a very, very small town in Ohio. My graduating class was 115 people. And I didn't know anybody who was a socialist or a communist or a leftist. In fact, my family were Democrats. They voted Democrat. But most people I grew up around voted Republican. Almost every other family that we knew was Republican aligned, evangelical, Christian, conservative. And I got interested in socialism because I discovered it on my own. You know, I went to the library and read books on it. You know, my parents had really liked folk music, so I'd heard Woody Guthrie around the household, Pete Seeger, and I found out they were communists. And I got interested in socialism. And, you know, the more I got interested in socialism, I started looking at socialist groups. When I was in college, I became very active with different socialist groups. But one thing that I realized, you know, as I traveled around the world, and as I, you know, I really started traveling. I visited Iran, I visited Venezuela, I visited Ecuador, I visited Brazil. And I started to realize that there's something different about the American left. And when I would go to international communist gatherings, I was frequently asked, what is wrong with American communists? You know, in every other country in the world, almost, it seems like there's communist neighborhoods, communist territories, communists are elected to parliaments or the National Assembly or the Congress. But there's something about American communists that's just a little bit off, you know, and that it was a frustrating thing for me to see that communists in the United States very much occupy kind of this, you know, cosmopolitan bohemian milieu. You find communists in the United States in the urban centers, on college campuses, you know, you don't find them among the broad masses of people. And Bernie Sanders has done a lot to change that. I mean, Bernie Sanders is not a communist or a socialist. He's a reformer from like the Roosevelt tradition, a progressive, but, you know, he doesn't want to really challenge capitalism. But his movement has sparked a lot of conversation. And if you look at the polls that have come out, overwhelmingly, people in the United States are open to socialism like they've never been before. People in the United States, especially people under the age of 30, are really open to socialist and communist ideas. So, you know, as I traveled around the world, one thing that became very apparent to me is that everywhere socialism has ever been created, it's been unique. Mao's socialism was very different than Soviet socialism. Korean socialism is very different than Chinese socialism. The socialism in Cuba is very different than the socialism in Europe. You know, that socialism in Latin America, they talk about Bolivarian socialism after Simon Bolivar, who is the liberator of South America from the Spanish colonialists. In the Middle East, they developed Ba'athist Arab socialism, which, you know, it drew from Marxism, but it was a unique understanding of socialism for the Arab people. Now in China, they talk about socialism with Chinese characteristics and how they apply, you know, the Confucian tradition and some of the brilliance of China's 5,000-year-old civilization to developing socialism in China. And it occurred to me that, that, you know, if we're going to have socialism in the United States, it's going to have to be a socialism rooted in our unique circumstances. It's going to be different. It's not going to be a copy of what they have in some other country. It's going to be a unique form of socialism applied to our unique situation and our unique conditions. And then what I found that was fascinating is the Communist Party USA, when it was strong during the 1930s and 40s and up into the 50s, when it was being broken apart by McCarthyism, said the same thing. If you read William Z. Foster's writings, you read the presidential campaigns of William Z. Foster or Earl Browder, you read the books that were being published by international publishers in that era, they said the exact same thing. They said socialism will be uniquely American. We're not going to copy the Soviet Union. We'll draw from the Soviet Union. We'll learn from it. But we're going to develop a socialism rooted in our own conditions. And that understanding made me realize that this strategy of just trying to take over what they call the movement, right, of, you know, intellectuals, people who go to peace rallies, Rachel Maddow fans or whatever, liberal activists, wasn't correct. And there's a real need to go to the broad masses of people in the USA who are losing their homes, losing their jobs, seeing their incomes decrease, very frustrated, very angry with the system. Those are the people that are going to build socialism in the United States. And in order to do that, we need to develop a socialism that doesn't come across as an attack on the American people. Socialism will improve the lives of almost all Americans, except for the ultra rich. And we need to make clear that socialism is the only way out of this crisis. Socialism is about building a better life for all working people. Of course, starting with those who are the most oppressed, those who face discrimination, and they will be given special priority. But the aim is to build a whole new country for the people. And that throughout U.S. history, there's a whole history of progressive forces. John Brown, the heroic abolitionist who fought against slavery. You can talk about the labor movement, the suffragists, Eugene Debs, the folks who built the CIO like Gus Hall. You know, there's so many progressive and revolutionary people in U.S. history who fought against wars that were unjust, fought against slavery, fought against racism, fought for the rights of women, of LGBT people, et cetera. And that when socialism comes to the United States, and I believe it will, I hope it's within my lifetime, it will be a socialism that comes out of that progressive tradition in American history. It's going to be that tradition, that progressive side of American history. It won't be the racism, won't be settler colonialism, won't be slavery, it won't be imperialism and war, but it'll be the progressive side of America taking power. It'll be all the progressives and visionaries and innovators and free thinkers and activists and radicals of U.S. history. It'll be their legacy finally conquering Washington, D.C. That's what socialism will be. And it will be unique, and it'll be based on unique historical conditions. It'll be based on millions of people being brought into the political process and empowered. But that's what socialism will be in the United States. And if we hold on to the illusion that we're going to adopt Juche, or we're going to adopt Deng Xiaoping theory over here, or we're going to recreate the Soviet Union in North America, we're just deluding ourselves. That's fun to fantasize about, might be fun to LARP that way and dress in costumes, but that's not really where socialism is going to come from. It's going to come from the progressive side of American history and the broad masses of people in their millions being empowered.
Great. I think that's a great analysis. And I really think that's a really good way to think about things. I think people tend to think we're just trying to create, you know, Soviet Union 2.0, stuff like that. Obviously, we can draw on that history, but I think you're on the money with that kind of description. So kind of, I know that maybe utopian speculation into the future is not exactly the most materialist kind of perspective on things. Obviously, we need to be basing our things in the conditions of our time. So I'm curious what you specifically might visualize a socialist movement, a constructive socialist movement, to look like given the material conditions of the United States as it is right now. I know that you talk a lot about the advantages that China has had with its market socialist economy, which I'm very open to, given that they have started from a place of severe underdevelopment and they need this sort of market economy in order to kind of expand their development, expand their all that kind of stuff. But I'm curious, in a country like the United States that is already very highly developed, what kind of space do you see for market socialism or non-market socialism, more planned, state-controlled kind of economic system going on in the United States? I'm curious where exactly you see this sort of system fitting in the United States. What would you expect would be an ideal suit? Like, what do you think would suit the conditions that the United States is under, would you say?
Well, first of all, in order for it to be socialism, profits can't be in command any longer. It needs to be a centrally planned economy so that public good is what the economy is organized to serve. You have, you know, 5-year plans, and the government, which is based among a mass popular movement, controls the economy. The corporations, the industries are controlled by the people. That's socialism. But within that, would there be room for a market sector? I think there would be. I mean, obviously, it would be up to what the masses of people and their millions wanted as they were organized and taking power. But I can't see a United States where, you know, your local restaurant, think about your local restaurant, where that's a government operation. I can't see that. Maybe they would get a stimulus check from the government. Maybe they'd be highly regulated to make sure their workers are treated fairly. Maybe it would be a worker cooperative. So every worker in that restaurant got a share of the profits and no one exploited anyone else's labor. But I just don't see a United States coming into being where hotels and restaurants and, you know, and little corner stores are all, you know, government operations where some big bureaucracy in Washington, D.C. regulates all of them and makes all the decisions. I just don't see that happening. You know, I see a society coming into being where creativity is fostered, where we have small, you know, tech startup companies, for example. We have people inventing new apps and new devices. But we have state central planning. We have banking and the lending of money in the hands of the government. We have natural resources in the hands of the government. So the proceeds from our oil and our gas and our timber all go into the public budget. I see a country where our major industries like automobile manufacturing and steel and you name it, meatpacking and, big business agriculture are all under the control of the state and operated according to a central plan. But we have a market sector. And let me emphasize that there's a lot of confusion about worker cooperatives these days, because worker cooperatives are good, right? And the one of the problems of capitalism being the exploitation of the worker by the capitalist is eliminated with worker cooperatives. But not all the problems of capitalism, because they still function according to the market. A worker cooperative is an independent institution, and it's trying to maximize its own profits. You could have a worker cooperative that made weapons that would want wars, because then everyone who worked there would make more profits from selling weapons, right? That worker cooperatives in and of themselves don't eliminate the problems of the market. They don't eliminate the problems of capitalism. And that's where I think some of these voices like Vosch and others don't quite understand that the problem of profits in command ultimately can only be resolved with central planning, with an economy in which the major commanding heights are public property and not operated according to profits. But worker cooperatives would have a role in that. Private enterprises, I think, would have a role in that. I don't think that that's the ultimate difference between capitalism and socialism. And that, the Soviet Union, the reason that everything, absolutely everything, was run by the government in the Soviet Union was because they didn't have it first. The country had been destroyed. It was an impoverished agrarian country. First, they had the new economic policy where they had, some private farming and private businesses. And then they had the five-year plan. So they built up a huge state-run economic apparatus. And then they started to have some really big problems by the 60s and 70s. And they tried to address those problems with perestroika and glasnost. And perestroika and glasnost made the problems worse and ultimately led to the demise of the Soviet Union. Well, in China, they were able to implement market reforms in a way that actually strengthened the socialist system rather than weakened it. That you're always going to have in any society, you're going to have people that are college professors. You're going to have people that are doctors. You're going to have people who function perhaps as legal experts or lawyers of some type. And those people are going to be frustrated if they're forced to become government employees and they're stifled and their ability to be creative is held back by government bureaucrats and they feel like they're just kind of a cog in a big bureaucratic machine. It's better to have those people start their own enterprises, be they cooperative or private, let them go out and be creative, and maybe the government control them, subsidize them, unleash them, and utilize their creativity to build socialism. I think that's necessary. And ultimately the goal, let's remember, is communism, is a world with so much vast material abundance, so much prosperity that the need for any coercion fades away, that so much wealth has been created, that the need for regulation of distribution kind of goes away. People just kind of take what they need, do what they feel like doing, and we all kind of live comfortably. That's the ultimate goal of communism, and that's based on vast, vast material abundance. And the problem is that the socialist societies that have existed have had the opposite of that. They've had very, very low levels of development. They've had socialism because their revolutions have been fought mainly for national liberation, because as countries, their ability to develop, even to basic capitalist levels, was held back by imperialism. So they're building socialism on the basis of scarcity. That's why they've had a very authoritarian political model in some cases. That's why we've seen, just struggles to industrialize and build things up. But building socialism in the first world and building socialism on the basis of an economy that's already constructed, I think is going to be a little bit different. It's going to be something that's not been done before. We haven't seen the construction of socialism in the first world. I mean, perhaps maybe East Germany is an example of that, but it was devastated by war and it was only a chunk of Germany as a country. We haven't seen, the construction of socialism in a Western country, a Western fully developed imperialist country yet. So when that happens, it'll be something that'll be new and we'll be pioneers, just like the Soviets were pioneers and developed, really existing socialism, the Marxist-Leninist model that was successful during the Cold War, just like Deng Xiaoping pioneered market socialism, just like the Bolivarians pioneered what they did, taking power in elections and then having new constitutions and creating a new state apparatus. We're going to be pioneers here in the United States, and we're going to have to figure things out on our own. We're going to make mistakes, but I'm confident that we will have a huge amount of success, and we will eventually build something very beautiful. And the main thing about socialism in the United States is it'll be about changing our relationship with countries around the world. No more will it be Western corporations that operate in a predatory way, beating down the economies of countries around the world, impoverishing them and looting them to make super profits for Wall Street and London. Instead, we'll have an economy that functions on the basis of win-win cooperation. where countries get wealthier by trading with us and we get wealthier by trading with them. And the likelihood of war decreases significantly because the more the world becomes economically interlocked with different trade routes and different big modes of transportation, the more we depend on each other and the less likely we are to see war and aggression and destruction.
Yeah, I think your point there about removing the economic foundations of exploitation is very important because, like you said, a lot of people are very caught up on what it means to have a worker cooperative. And of course, I guess you reduce exploitation to a degree, but you got to remove that economic foundation. And that seems to be the holdup for a lot of people. I have a question here for you. So to me, one of the more interesting things to watch on your YouTube live streams has been seeing your understanding on certain topics grow over time. One that stands out in my mind is your perception of what you coined the synthetic left. Now, this is a topic that you've expanded on over the last several months, and now I understand that you'll actually be releasing a book on this subject. So here's my question. What is the synthetic left? Where did it come from? And how does it impede the genuine left?
You know, it's really interesting. If you look at old, communist literature from like the 60s and 70s, especially international communist publications, you would see articles about CIA funding of art galleries and CIA funding of music, concerts and things like that. And when I was an activist in, certain leftist groups, it would be kind of whispered, this group is funded by the CIA, this group is funded by the CIA, but we never say that in public. It was just kind of whispered. And it's just been kind of something that no one wants to talk about. But at this point, so much has been published, so many, classified documents have been released. It's just a matter of fact that is admitted by the CIA on their own website, that's admitted by so much academic research. I mean, I didn't do the research myself. This is all done by other scholars. It is a matter of public record that in the 1950s, the CIA began a policy of covertly funding left-wing writers, artists, intellectuals, in order to create a layer of left-wing thought that was contrary to Marxism-Leninism and was opposed to the Soviet Union. And it was just the beginning, though. From that, we got a whole milieu of writers who called themselves leftists, who broke with the basic tenets of Marxism, broke with the concept of historical progress, broke with the goals of socialism, and created a whole new dynamic of what left-wing thought is. And that if you look at what was done, if you look at figures like Susan Sontag, Theodore Adorno, I'm trying to think who else, Irving Howe, what these people espoused and what they believed was very much contrary to what Marx believed, to what social democracy had believed prior to that, that a new strand of political thought emerged. And that strand of political thought is labeled leftism. In fact, there's a whole thing, the alt-right crowd, they always talk about cultural Marxism. Oh, look, it's the cultural Marxists. Well, and they criticize, thinkers, and they say, this is just like Stalin, this is just like Mao. But what they're missing is a lot of the stuff that they're decrying is people who were vehemently opposed to Stalin, vehemently opposed to Mao, vehemently opposed to the Soviet Union. And actually, this synthetic left, this new political entity that was synthetically created, played a very big role in overthrowing socialism in Eastern Europe, most especially. When I was in college, I took classes and I'd have professors say things like, the USSR wasn't overthrown by Reagan and his military spending. It was overthrown by Beatles music and the art of Jackson Pollock. And I would roll my eyes and think that's the stupidest thing I ever heard. Well, I didn't know how right they were. That was very much the case, that the funding of art, the funding of intellectuals who appeared left-wing and socialist but were anti-communist, the work of Zbigniew Brzezinski to manipulate the dissident and intellectual sectors of the former Soviet Union and Eastern Europe, that is what won the Cold War for the United States. It was covert efforts by the liberal wing of the American establishment and intelligence agencies that did it. Jackson Pollock is a great example. Jackson Pollock was a painter, and he was actually friendly to the Communist Party in the 1930s. But in the 50s, the CIA thought it was quite interesting because Jackson Pollock is famous for just taking paint and just kind of splattering it on the canvas, abstract art. He doesn't paint pictures of people. There's no political message. It's just kind of lots of exciting colors splattered on a canvas. Maybe it looks really great if you're on drugs, you know, if you take, you know, psychedelics, I've never done that, but maybe if you're high on drugs and you look at one of his paintings, you feel really excited. But it doesn't depict people. It doesn't depict a clear political message. And the CIA thought that was useful. And they wrote about this. They said it was useful because in the Soviet Union, the state was producing socialist realism art, right? And there was art that, you know, portrayed workers' struggles and fighting for justice, put forward a Marxist message. And Roosevelt, you know, during the 1930s, he paid all kinds of artists to produce not socialist realism, but social realism art. All across the United States, in post offices and state capitol buildings, you can see beautiful paintings, a lot of them painted by card-carrying socialists and communists that portray working people, building things, that portray the American Revolution or the Civil War. There's a beautiful painting in the state capitol building in Kansas showing John Brown holding a rifle in the air. It's just beautiful stuff. This was social realism. That was considered to be a threat because it was building up mass popular movements and it was, you know, aligned with the Soviet Union and supporting labor unions and such. And so the CIA covertly started funding abstract art and saying, look, in the Soviet Union, you've got all this totalitarian art, right? And it portrays people and such. But, you know, in our free Western countries, Jackson Pollock, he just splatters paint on a canvas and he's celebrated as an artist. If you come to the free West, anybody can be an artist, a famous artist or a painter, because look at Jackson Pollock. It was a propaganda effort. But it gets worse than that. If you read the writings of Susan Sontag, for example, she starts claiming that the Soviet Union is fascism. She actually says that communism is fascism. It's successful fascism, fascism with a human face. And why do they say the Soviet Union is fascist? Because the Soviet government, you know, believes in right and wrong. Because the Soviet government mobilizes the population to get things done, because the Soviet government enacts popular will. And you start getting this idea that whenever people are being mobilized and you have a government, you know, organizing the economy and mobilizing the people to build up the country, that is fascist. And leftism started to stop being associated with fighting for ordinary people and their needs and started being about intellectuals and their desire for freedom, right? And their desire for not feeling alienated. You know, it's so bizarre, but you know, George Orwell, in school, I was required to read his work. We read Animal Farm, we read 1984, and my little public school in Ohio in a small town. That's required reading, this anti-totalitarian yep. literature. But there's a reason that that's required reading in American schools. There's a reason that the CIA paid for a cartoon version of the movie, of the book Animal Farm to be produced and sent all over the world as a movie. Because it's effective anti-communism, right? Straight up McCarthyist right-wing anti-communism kind of sickens people. They can smell it. They know what it's all about. It's over the top. It's dangerous. But when it's anti-communism that comes from a left-wing place and appeals to feelings that a lot of leftists have, like they don't fit in with society, they feel alienated, they don't like authority, when it appeals to that and then pushes that in an anti-communist direction, it's far, far more effective.
Yeah, it is amazing to me. You described it as a propaganda effort, the creation of the synthetic left. And it does amaze me how successful that actually was. Because, I mean, we're used to hearing it from the right, how terrible the Soviet Union was. But the fact that you hear this, so much of this stuff coming from what's considered the left, it really validifies it for a lot of people that this must be like a genuine thing, that the Soviet Union is recognized as being horrible. But you mentioned like, yeah, supporting like the Beatles, like the CIA and stuff like that. I mean, a lot of this stuff sounds like it could be a conspiracy theory now, but you know, in retrospect, like we look back and we can see where the CIA was literally sending out like women to give drugs to these bands and to make sure that they were like doing some more of this abstract kind of like music in a way. So it was a serious effort on their part, and they were very concerned about shaping the way we view socialism.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, a lot is written about it. And, you know, Adorno, Theodore Adorno, who's kind of the father of the Frankfurt School, which is, if you study Marxist academia, right, they're just loved. They're considered the Marxist academics of the post-World War II era. I mean, his first, first publications that are widely circulated are in Der Monat, which is a CIA-funded magazine in Germany, a socialist magazine covertly funded by the CIA in Germany. And that's a matter of public record that the CIA paid for Der Monat. In fact, the editor of it, Melvin, I'm trying to remember his name. I don't want to get his name wrong, but the editor of Der Monat, I think Melvin something, It was widely understood that he himself may be a CIA agent. He denied that he actually worked for the CIA until his deathbed, but he admitted, yes, the CIA was paying for his magazine the whole time. But what's very bizarre is that, you know, a lot of the people that were hired by the CIA to put out Partisan Review, which is considered one of the key intellectual texts, you know, the intellectual magazines of the 1950s, a lot of the people hired were former members of the Communist Party USA who had been kicked out for being Trotskyists. The editor of it was Philip Rov, who'd been a leader of a Trotskyite faction and expelled from the Communist Party. You had Irving Kristol, who, it's so bizarre, Irving Kristol had been a Trotskyist, and he joined the U.S. military during World War II, and he hated the people in his unit of the U.S. Army, right? He thought they were barbarians. He said, I can't build socialism with these people, and he turned against the working class, and so he denounced socialism outright. But then after the war, he immediately got hired by the CIA to run the Congress for Cultural Freedom program to start, you know, subsidizing all these fake left-wing magazines. But then what's even more bizarre is in the 70s, he became the father of the neocons, of neoconservatism. And he's recognized as the intellectual father of neoconservatism, this Trotskyist who turned against the working class after serving with them in the military. He liked workers when he never met them, when he was an intellectual in New York City. But when he actually served alongside workers in the anti-fascist war, he didn't like them. So then he becomes an anti-communist, but then he gets the job of running fake socialist and fake communist publications. And then he becomes the father of neoconservatism. You look at that history. Irving Howe is an interesting figure. Irving Howe is an intellectual in New York City. He's part of the Trotskyist movement. He and Trotsky, you know, they have a disagreement. Trotsky says the Soviet Union is what he calls a degenerate workers' state, meaning that it's still got socialist foundations, but Stalin is no good and it's counter-revolutionary bureaucracy. Irving Howe, Max Shackman, others, they say, well, the Soviet Union is completely bad. It's not socialist at all. So they cut their ties. The ISO, the International Socialist Organization, traces its roots back to this disagreement with Trotsky. Regardless, Irving Howe, he ends up becoming this very, very prominent writer. He's writing for Partisan Review, the CIA-funded magazine. He's writing articles for the New York Times as a Marxist, denouncing the Vietnam War protesters and saying, well, I'm a Marxist, I'm a socialist, but these Vietnam War protesters are too extreme. They're too pro-Stalinist. They like Ho Chi Minh. Of course, he's denouncing the protests in support of the Palestinians and saying that the Marxist movement is anti-Semitic, and he's writing that for the New York Times, the New York Times Review of Books. They're publishing his articles. He later goes on to be a founder of Democratic Socialists of America, and he's one of the founding members of it. You can talk about Michael Harrington, who is considered the father of Democratic Socialists of America. Michael Harrington served in the administration of Lyndon Johnson, and he was key in crafting some of the poverty programs, and he made statements supporting the Vietnam War, supporting the Bay of Pigs invasion. He did turn against the Vietnam War eventually, but you look at the ability to cultivate what they referred to at the time. This was widely known at the time. They referred to them as State Department socialists, of people that maybe they liked Trotsky or maybe they liked socialism, but they were on the U.S. government side of the Cold War, cultivating these people, funding these people, and making these people the spokespersons for leftism. That was just common practice by the U.S. government. And people didn't try to deny it. Gloria Steinem, who's considered to be the most important feminist in like the 1970s, right? The founder of Ms. Magazine. She's a founder of Democratic Socialists of America. For years, she tried to cover up that she had been a CIA employee. But now, I mean, just go to her Wikipedia page. It shows completely that not only was she working with the CIA, she ran a research division for the CIA that disrupted communist youth festivals in the early 1960s. And when she was a college student, she and Zbigniew Brzezinski were going to communist youth festivals around the world and setting off stink bombs. And she was a full-on CIA operative long before she became the voice of American feminism. So we have to realize that the synthetic left is a real thing. And this isn't just crazy conspiracy theories. This isn't just sectarianism. This is a matter of public record.
So this is a really interesting conversation here that you've been talking about with the synthetic left and everything like that. But my next question is, when we're talking about activism within the United States, what exactly would you say would be the best example of socialist activism that's either current or historical? Like activism strategy, I would say more broadly, that we in the United States should try to emulate in order to form an effective movement.
Well, a couple things come to mind. I wish I had a quick, concise answer for you, but this is something I've spent so much time thinking about and researching and analyzing. I can't give you the quick, concise answer you might want. But in terms of historical work, I mean, the unemployment councils that the Communist Party USA ran in the 1930s were dynamic and amazing. You read about this, how in every major city of the United States, you had unemployment councils. Every block was organized. When somebody would be kicked out of their home and their stuff would be thrown into the street, the Communist Party would show up and put their stuff back in their home. And these were interracial organizations at a time when the country was very, very racially segregated. And the hunger marches that they organized, where tens of thousands of people would, you know, just pour into Washington, D.C. or pour into New York City's Union Square demanding work or wages now. This is what forced the Roosevelt administration to create the Works Progress Administration and hire the unemployed. And the dynamic work they did. The Communist Party was key in organizing the Bonus March in 1931, where thousands and thousands of veterans camped out on the National Mall in Washington, D.C., demanding that they get paid a bonus, a veteran's bonus. And they refused to leave, and the Army was forced to come in and drive them out. You look at that kind of organizing that the Communist Party did, and how they eventually moved into unionizing the industries, the mainstream unions, the AFL wouldn't touch what they called unskilled workers. So it was communists who organized the dock workers in San Francisco, the textile workers and the sharecroppers of the South, the meatpacking workers of Chicago, the Teamsters, the electrical power workers in Toledo, Ohio. All these workers that they said they were unskilled, that the AFL wouldn't organize, the communists did organize. And it was that ability to organize people, to feed people, to lead them in demanding and winning economic relief that made the Communist Party so powerful and forced the Roosevelt administration to cooperate with communists. I mean, let's not forget that during the Roosevelt years, Roosevelt even had Gilbert Green, who was the leader of the Young Communist League, sleep over at the White House. When Congress was investigating Roosevelt for his alliance with the Communist Party. So he made a statement. He said, okay, you're going to, subpoena this young communist. Well, he's going to sleep over at the White House, making a statement of support of communists. So that was very important. You talk about the Black Panthers and their free breakfast program and how they were just loved in every sector of the Black community. But I can think of some more recent examples. When I was working in Cleveland, and I haven't been working politically in Cleveland for years. I live in New York City. I've lived here for, the last half decade or so. But when I was working in Cleveland, there was an organization. It was not a communist organization. It was a Black nationalist organization. It was called Black on Black Crime Incorporated. And it was led by Art McCoy, who was a barbershop owner, an activist, a Black nationalist activist. And when they had a meeting on the east side of Cleveland, every Wednesday night, there'd be 80 people, over 100 people there, sometimes 200 people. They'd be there. Anything that was going on in the community, whether it was the closing of a power plant, the closing of a hospital, the need for better traffic lights, police brutality, anything going on in the neighborhood, they were talking about it. Everyone knew that that was the center of community power in Cleveland, was this Black nationalist group. And that's the role that the Communist Party USA played in Brooklyn, in Harlem in the 1930s, in San Francisco, in Los Angeles, in Chicago. That's the role that the Communist Party played in working class neighborhoods during the 1930s. That's the role the Black Panthers played during the 1960s and 70s in African-American neighborhoods around this country. And ultimately, that should be the role that communists aspire to play. They should be the centers of the community, the most well-loved people in the neighborhood who get things done, who, if you're in trouble, if there's problems, you can go and talk to them. So that's one thing. The other thing is there needs to be an ideological shift. The synthetic left has usurped socialism. Nowadays in the United States, people think of socialism as young college kids going out and breaking windows or people on Twitter screaming and accusing people of being sexist and transphobic. There needs to be a shift, and there needs to be an ideological effort to build real socialist politics among the broad masses of people. In Lenin's lecture on the 1905 revolution, which was the dress rehearsal for the 1917 revolution in Russia, Lenin talks about how one of the big changes was how the Russian public understood the term revolutionary. It used to be, when Russians, average Russians, heard the term revolutionary, they associated it with students, because that had been who all the revolutionaries were. They were the college kids, the students, the wealthy students studying with would read about the French Revolution and form little revolutionary groups. But what changed in the lead up to the 1905 revolution was suddenly among the population, the word revolutionary became associated with strikers and with factory workers, right? Because it was revolutionaries were in the factories. And suddenly the image of what a revolutionary was in the mind of the average Russian person dramatically shifted. That's what needs to happen. We need to change how the American people view a revolutionary or a socialist or a Marxist or a leftist. They need to think of it as someone in their neighborhood, someone who loves their country, loves their community, and wants to make it better and sees the billionaire banker capitalists as the enemy and wants to stop war and wants to improve people's lives. Not somebody who wants chaos, not somebody who's rich and privileged and speaks a language of academia, but instead a community organizer, someone who cares for the people and someone who is fighting for the people to control the major industries and banks and organize the economy to serve public good and not profits.
Fascinating. Yeah, I think that's right on the money. Absolutely. We need to be addressing the material needs of people first and foremost. So I think you're absolutely right on there. I'm curious. So with most revolutions, like with the Russian Revolution, it was World War One. With the Chinese Revolution, it was Japanese invasion and the war that resulted after that. Usually there needs to be some sort of crisis period in order to kind of accelerate revolutionary consciousness among the people. So I'm wondering what kind of crises or what kind of things do you think could possibly be accelerating revolutionary consciousness in people in the next coming years?
Well, the economic crisis we're in has already accelerated consciousness. I got to tell you, as somebody, I mean, I've only been doing this kind of politics for maybe a decade. I mean, I was reading about it in high school, but I became active as a college student. And the amount of change in the public consciousness that I've already witnessed is massive. I mean, the public is against these wars. The public thinks the government is corrupt and working for someone else. I remember when the USA invaded Iraq in 2003, I mean, there was so much support for it. Even in New York City, the anti-war, you know, feeling was almost the minority. I mean, there was a lot of people who just trusted the government, thought the government was right. And public consciousness has really shifted in my lifetime. I've seen it happen. And now the fact that we're in the middle of this pandemic, that unemployment is reaching Great Depression levels, we're seeing public consciousness escalate. The problem is that ideologically, a lot of people's consciousness, a lot of people understand these wars are wrong. They understand the government is corrupt. They understand that, you know, that big bankers and millionaires have all the power and we don't. And they say, well, the answer is we need real capitalism back. We got to be libertarians. Or they say the answer is it's globalists and we need nationalism, economic nationalism. There's white supremacist racist ideas are widespread. Flat earth ideas are widespread. Anything but Marxism, anything but socialism seems to be widespread. People will talk about the Illuminati. They'll talk about the thing high up on the thing. They'll talk about anti-Semitism. They'll talk about reptile people, but they won't talk about the capitalist ruling class. There's been an ideological erosion. It used to be that when people went to prison, if they got political, they read the writings of Huey Newton and George Jackson, and they became Marxists. Well, now people in prison, they read conspiracy books about the Illuminati. It used to be people in the military, if they were turning against the wars, they would start reading the writings of Ho Chi Minh and Mao and become revolutionary. Well, now in the military, people are turning against the wars, but they're reading Atlas Shrugged by Ayn Rand. They're reading Behold a Pale Horse and right-wing conspiracy literature and all of this. There is an ideological erosion. And the mistake that a lot of the organized left makes is they say, well, we just got to have more action. We got to build the movement. I've heard that my whole life. Build the movement, build the movement, build the movement. Well, the reason that the movement is kind of at a dead end is not because enough people aren't just protesting. It's because there has been an ideological erosion. And that's why doing what we're doing right now and having podcasts and making videos and producing books and pamphlets and doing everything we can to roll back this ideological erosion and put out the politics of Gus Hall and William Z. Foster and Eugene Debs, and put out, you know, the politics of Huey Newton, the politics of Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, to bring back the politics that's missing from this whole equation. That's why that's so, so important. If we don't have an ideological shift, things are never going to get better. You know, street heat, action in the streets in and of itself doesn't lead to things getting better. And in fact, chaos in our time, chaos in and of itself can actually make things worse. because it creates more of a justification for a police state clampdown. It leads to the instability that can be seized upon by different forces from the right, from the centrist left, you know, that just chaos, street heat, the movement in and of itself is not going to lead any place good. The only thing that can really lead the way out of this is socialism. Maybe it won't be explicitly Marxist socialism. Maybe it'll be Christian socialism. Maybe it'll be utopian socialism. But the only way we're going to get out of this is if we lead the public toward public control of the major banks and industries, central planning, a planned economy where the working people control the major centers of economic power. You and I know that that's the only way out of this crisis. And the only way we're going to get people to come to that conclusion is by preaching it to them and by telling it to them. And that movements in and of themselves don't lead there. This is what Lenin wrote in his book, What is to Be Done? He talked about bowing to spontaneity and how, you know, if you just go after whatever's there, if, you know, if you just follow after the workers saying yay and applauding whatever they do, you're not going to have a revolution, that it takes a change in consciousness.
Yeah. So Caleb, I've heard you discuss a topic or a concept that I find particularly intriguing. You know, we were talking about, you were saying other people look at all these other ways to analyze the ruling class. They'll say, oh, they could be alien shapeshifters or they're the Illuminati or something like that. But as Marxists, you know, we understand that our concept of the bourgeoisie is a little more complex than just, you know, some type of secretive group in a room. So you've spoken what you describe as a divide in the ruling class, which is composed of a managerial class, meaning the major monopolies, trusts, and cartels. Then we have the entrepreneurial bourgeoisie, or the petty bourgeoisie-minded ruling class. So now we're seeing studies that come out that indicate that 30% of small businesses may be closing their doors for good by August. And this is due to the coronavirus, of course. This restructuring of the economy will surely open up some market share. So here's my question. How do you see these two factions of the ruling class? How do you see them as trying to advance their interests in this new playing field?
Well, it goes right down the line. You know, Jeff Bezos is making out like a bandit amid this pandemic. Amazon's stock is higher than it has ever been, $1.1 trillion. At this point, Amazon is hiring workers in big numbers. Everyone's stuck at home. They're ordering from Amazon. He's doing great. Meanwhile, Hobby Lobby, which is a big supporter of Donald Trump, right? They have closed their stores indefinitely, right? Home Depot is on limited hours every day. Bernie Marcus, who's the owner of Home Depot, is a big supporter of Donald Trump. He's losing money right now. And it goes perfectly down the line. You know, Betsy DeVos, she is the owner of a multi-level marketing scam called Amway, and they sell Tupperware, right? They're not having Tupperware parties in an atmosphere where, you know, social gatherings are not permitted. So a lot of the Trump-supporting capitalists that are lower-level capitalists are losing out. For example, the frackers, right? The fracking companies, those who extract oil from the shale with the process of hydraulic fracking. They are on the verge of collapse because of the oil price drop. There's low demand for oil as the economy has slowed down. And as a result, these fracking companies are going to go under. Well, they're the major competitor of the big four super major oil companies, ExxonMobil, BP, Chevron, and Shell Oil. And if you look at, you know, the big four super major oil companies that are delightedly watching their competitors go under amid the low oil prices, you look at Jeff Bezos. These are big supporters of the Democrats. These are big supporters of Joe Biden, who are opponents of Donald Trump. And so the reason we're seeing Trump supporters out in the streets demanding that the businesses open up and end the lockdown is because the people paying for the pro-Trump movement are going to be economically demolished. Meanwhile, the reason that we're seeing, you know, calls for more public safety and ridicule of Trump in the handling of this crisis is because the capitalists that oppose Trump are you know, seeking to keep this going as long as they can because they want to make money. So, you know, you have to look at it that way. And we have to keep in mind this division between, you know, kind of the ultra rich and the rich. I mean, this is not the petty bourgeoisie versus the bourgeoisie. This is the ultra bourgeoisie versus the bourgeoisie. I mean, Betsy DeVos is not petty bourgeois. She's a billionaire. Bernie Marcus is a billionaire. A lot of the Trump supporting capitalists are billionaires. But it's a longstanding divide in the post-war United States. You know, the Rockefeller family, that's Standard Oil, you know, they are so wealthy They are beyond wealthy. The amount of wealth they have is like hard to calculate. There's actually a very good book called Rockefeller Syndrome. It's by Ferdinand Lundberg, and it's published at the time that they were making a member of the Rockefeller family into vice president. And he tries to figure out how much money the Rockefeller family has, and he can't figure it out because it's wrapped up in so many elaborate trusts and cartels and foundations, and it's impossible to tell how much money they have. Those folks are so wealthy that they would prefer to have stability in society, right? They're not worried about their short-term profits because they're so wealthy that they're going to have stability in society. Now, if things were to change, if the economy were to drastically change or the government suddenly started nationalizing things, they might be in trouble. But as long as society remains stable, they're going to be on top. So they want stability. Whereas Betsy DeVos, Bernie Marcus, the fracking companies, they want to make money. They're newly rich. They're the nouveau riche. They're concerned about their short-term profits. They want their profits to increase. So the Rockefellers and, you know, the ultra rich, the Morgans, the DuPonts, they want to stabilize U.S. society so that they stay at the top of the mountain. Meanwhile, the lower levels of capital that support Trump, they want deregulated capitalism. They want more of a libertarian economic approach so that they can make money, so that they can try to get ahead, so that they can stay on top. They have a different approach to things. And if you look at it, the Rockefellers, they're the primary funders of the Council on Foreign Relations, which is, you know, the think tank where most of U.S. foreign policy is dreamed up. It's the CIA's brain. The Rockefellers fund the Asia Society. They fund a lot of the think tanks and the institutes that are key in setting up U.S. foreign policy that tend to be pretty liberal, that tend to favor LGBT rights, that tend to favor feminism and things like that. And you know, maybe at this point, they're even open to a little bit of social democracy, maybe some health care for the population, you know, maybe universal basic income to stabilize things. Whereas, you know, the Trump-supporting capitalists are the ones that really believe that capitalism is the best system and really are desperate to maximize their own profits and want the government's hands completely off. And I think it's a problem that in a lot of left and Marxist circles, there's not a recognition that there's a left wing of the ruling class. There's just this assumption that all capitalists are Republicans and Democrats. Maybe they're not truly progressive, but they're on our side, or their opposition to capital, maybe it's just not good enough. No, there is a section of the ruling class that wants to do things the Democrats' way. There's another section of the ruling class that wants to do things Republicans' way. And that these divides in the ruling class are very important. And eventually, I mean, at this point, I don't see Marxists and leftists having enough influence to take sides in this. But eventually, you know, these divisions within the ruling class can be very, very strategic. It was an alliance with the Roosevelt wing of the capitalist class and the Rockefeller family in particular that actually made the Communist Party so powerful, because the factory owners in the 1930s were pushing fascism. And we're pushing for the USA to align with Nazi Germany, and we're pushing for a military coup against Roosevelt. The Rockefeller family and Roosevelt was forced to align with the Communist Party and was forced to support the labor movement and to allow the communists to go and organize workers. So it was a strategic alliance from a quote unquote democratic wing of the bourgeoisie against a quote unquote fascist wing of the bourgeoisie that enabled the Communist Party to vastly expand during the 1930s. It was very strategic and it had a very good outcome. And so, you know, tactical alliances with sections of the ruling class are absolutely necessary. The Bolsheviks took power because of a tactical alliance they had with the capitalists of Russia that opposed World War I. Many Russian capitalists were strongly opposed to war with Germany because they made money by trading with Germany. Germany and Russia are right next to each other. And the Bolsheviks, they were the anti-war party. They wanted to end World War I. And as the Russian government, in the aftermath of the Russian Revolution, the provisional government was facing being overthrown by General Kornilov. Kornilov wanted to set up a military dictatorship that would just completely obliterate all the anti-war opposition within Russia and force Russia into a position where it was going to aggressively continue World War I. It was those anti-war capitalists who wanted to do business with Germany. They weren't peace-loving. They weren't pacifists. They just wanted to make money, you know, doing business with Germany, that had to align with the Bolsheviks. And the Bolsheviks had to build up their self-defense forces. And they eventually beat back Kornilov and were able to eventually take power because they strengthened themselves through an alliance with the anti-war capitalists of Russia. You know, in China, it was mainly defending Chinese capitalists from the Japanese invaders that made the Chinese Communist Party so strong. Nobody could fight the Japanese like Mao could. Mao built this amazing army. and won a lot of capitalists to sympathize with the Communist Party because they were so effective in defeating the invaders. And that looking at these divisions within the ruling class and looking at what role communists could play in such a division is very, very important. Now, like I said, I don't think we're at the point where any kind of strategic alliance could be made because Marxism is too weak. At this point, we need to just build our own movement. But at the same time, we should be looking at the division within the ruling class and figuring out how we can maneuver within it eventually and move toward eventually taking power. Every revolution in history has started out with a crisis within the ruling class, where the ruling class starts recruiting workers and making workers politically active and using workers as foot soldiers to resolve fights within the ruling class. You have fascist Bonapartism, you have progressive Bonapartism and social democracy. Working people are brought into motion in politics as the ruling class is fighting amongst itself. And communists look at those moments where workers are suddenly being brought into politics as the ruling class is fighting, and they start maneuvering within that, right? When there's a crisis in all of society, when workers are suddenly being brought into motion as the ruling class is fighting among itself, that's the moment for communists to move and to start organizing and maneuvering within that towards the goal of eventually creating a socialist society.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. And speaking on like the divide of the in the ruling class, I actually found this concept in Lenin's left-wing communism and infantile disorder. So, he talks about that. He says these points where there's conflicting interests between the bourgeoisie, we should definitely take advantage of those moments and use it for our interests. But I think you're a little right when you're saying that that we may not be quite there yet, but it's definitely something that we need to watch and be ready for. But I just wanted to add that to that. But sure. Yes.
Great. If I could step in and maybe ask part of a question. So Danky was having a few connection issues. So I want to kind of wrap up two of our questions kind of into one. So I know that you have hosted several debates between yourself and a few other people in the YouTube left sphere and other places as well. Most notably, I think recently you challenged the YouTuber Vosh to a debate. I'm going to kind of combine two things in here, but we were wondering, so when you're preparing for a debate or when you're challenged to a debate, I mean, communists on the left know that arguing online is pretty much a large percentage of what we do with most of our time. And so we're wondering, basically, how do you decide whether somebody is worth getting into a debate with? What is your thought methodology as to whether that would be a productive use of your time and energy and whether this would be a constructive debate or not? But also what your preparation work is like when you're preparing for a debate. How do you go about maybe doing any kind of preliminary research? How do you kind of structure your arguments and things like that? I think that could be a big help for a lot of people.
Oh, well, I feel like there are many factors that go into deciding. And honestly, there have been times where I've debated people and regretted it. And there's been times where I've debated people and thought it was really, really productive. The first time I ever debated anybody, I was in college. And what it was, is I was writing for my college newspaper. And I was writing articles about socialism, some of which were a little bit, I look back and I wasn't as good of a writer as I am now. And some of my arguments were a little bit silly. But this Republican on my campus started writing like articles every week to like rebut my articles. And so I had the idea of challenging him to a debate, and we did it, and it was packed. We promoted it and it was packed. It was like the biggest event on campus. It was amazing. And it was one of the most successful things. I had brought different socialist speakers to my campus, had different educational events, but never. I mean, at least 100 people turned out to the debate. The local activist community turned out to the debate. It was the west side of Cleveland, not a very big place with a lot of different people, but the local like John Birch Society came and took notes because there was communists on campus and they were concerned about it. And Republicans were there and this guy's fraternity came out. And I debated him, and the debate was very, very successful. People didn't expect me to do so well, people were kind of shocked. And it became a big hit on the internet. I mean, thousands of people have watched that debate on the internet now, years later, and it was a very successful event. And what's funny is after I staged that successful event on my campus, I was banned from the college newspaper. An alumni who was donating to the college called up the college and said if I was allowed to continue writing for the college paper, he would stop donating. So they had to ask me to stop writing for the college paper after my debate. So that was kind of amusing. That was the first big debate I ever did. And, you know, for a long time, I was an activist in a group that had a policy that we don't debate right wingers, which is the stupidest policy you could have right now. Right. As Americans are so open to exploring ideology, but so much trash is out there. You guys know it more than I do. So much trash is out there ideologically. So many people who should be communists or socialists who are mad at capitalism are becoming whatever, you know, some awful things, some weird things, anything but socialism is out there. Why would you not debate people? You know, why would you as a socialist group tell people not to debate leftists, you know, people with mistaken ideas? Why would you not do that? That was so problematic. But now as I do my own thing, yes, I engage in debates. I debated a white supremacist named Augustus Sol Invictus. That was a very successful debate. And actually Julian Assange tweeted it out. He was moved by the debate, impressed by it, and he tweeted it out to his audience. And that was a very successful event. I debated Destiny. Now, who's this popular game streamer? And I debated him. And in preparing for that debate, I did a lot of research because I knew that he would just do the classic, that's not true. Oh, you know, and I had to have a citation for every point I made that would go against his general narrative. So I prepared, and I had, if you watch that debate, I had New York Times articles, I had CIA World Factbook, I had all kinds of things. And I was very successful in that debate. I pulled out a lot of facts, and he was quite frustrated because he was prepared to respond to me the way he responds. He debates all kinds of people, white nationalists and anarchists and all kinds of stuff. And he was prepared to play like, let's talk about your utopia and I'm going to pick apart your utopia. And that's a really common fallacy that people will do when debating socialists. It's like, okay, I'm going to make you give me a perfect blueprint for a socialist society. And then I'm going to ask you questions about it. And obviously, you know, your blueprint's not going to be perfect. And I'm going to destroy you that way. It's not an honest tactic of debating, and you could frankly debate anyone that way. You know, get a Republican on there, make them tell you their ideal blueprint of the United States. You could destroy it. You could destroy anyone that way, right? No blueprint is going to hold up to that much scrutiny. So it's a dishonest way of debating. But I managed in that debate with Destiny to actually, you know, force him into awkward positions where he was saying things like, "What does life expectancy prove?" and trying to say that Cuba's healthcare system and its vast improvements of society didn't count for some reason. As you will recall, if you watched that debate, I made him quite uncomfortable because he assumed arrogantly that socialism has failed everywhere it's ever been tried. It's never been successful. That's very demonstrably false. It's one of the most false things ever. Socialism in the Soviet Union, in China, in Cuba, in many different countries has vastly improved living conditions for the population. That's very easy to demonstrate. And with his overconfidence, I mean, he's been brainwashed. He's gone to American schools. He believes that. I heard that in school. You know, we all heard that. And with his overconfidence, believing, you know, what his elementary school teachers told him about communism fails everywhere, he just couldn't understand. And when I was there and I had New York Times articles and CIA Word Factbook and information, he was just at a loss. He didn't know what to do. That was a successful debate. I've debated some other people. I debated a Trotskyist. I debated a couple white nationalists, this guy, Eric Stryker, and somebody else. And honestly, I regret that debate. People tell me I didn't look particularly bad, but I didn't think it was productive because the style of debating, the moderator wasn't moderating. So whenever I would make a point, I would be immediately interrupted with something that had nothing to do with what I was saying. I would say like, you know, I talked about the Communist Party's role in organizing the 1930s, and I'm immediately interrupted with, yeah, but they endorsed Hillary Clinton in 2016. You know, and I'm talking about the 1930s, right? I mean, it was like, I would say like, you know, socialism vastly improved life expectancies of people. Racism's not the answer. And I'd get interrupted with, you know, the price of tea in China is 14 an hour. And it's like unrelated points, just a constant rude interruption. To prevent me from making my points. And so now when I debate somebody, I want there to be a moderator to make sure that doesn't happen. That is an effective way of debating somebody and preventing them from, if you prevent them from making any coherent points, you just continue to interrupt them. That's a way of preventing successful debating. Now, this Vosh character who's on the internet, he calls himself a socialist, an anarchist, a libertarian socialist, whatever. He's in the habit of equating tankies, people who defend the Soviet Union, people who defend Mao's China, with fascists. And that's ridiculous because the Black Panthers were tankies. That's ridiculous because W.E.B. Du Bois was a tankie. That's ridiculous because so many anti-racist and progressive forces looked with admiration to the Soviet Union, were card-carrying members of the Communist Party. Communists were anti-racist and opposition to white supremacism and racism far before the mainstream of U.S. society was moving in that direction during the 1950s and 60s. So, you know, his entire premise is false. Now he wants me to just call into his show so he can interrupt me and verbally berate me and insult me like he does. And I've watched other clips of him, and that's how he operates. I will debate him, but I don't want him to do what these, you know, right-wing nationalists did that I debated, where they just interrupt you. You know, they just talk over you and they interrupt you. I want a fair debate where I can present my views, he can present his views. That's what I had with Destiny. I thought the moderator, this Faraday Speaks fellow, was a little bit biased toward Destiny. But regardless, I got to speak. And I've seen how Vosh has these little meltdowns. You can see it, by the way. On one live, someone brought up my name. It was like somebody posted a video in his stream from Michael Parenti. And so he started playing the video, and then he saw my name on the video tag, that it was from my channel, and he lost it. Watch it. You know, a couple, you know, maybe 30 seconds later, he's talking really, really fast and getting agitated. He's scared. And I have a feeling that because of, you know, I work for, you know, the TV network I work with, because I, you know, I support, you know, China and existing socialism, he's been warned. Whoever funds him and pays for his broadcast, could be a private foundation, could be a relative, whoever has enabled him to become so prominent, has warned him to stay the F away from me. I can guarantee you that. Probably that's what happened. They've said, you can keep getting funding to do your thing, you can bash the alt-right, you can urge people to vote for Biden, but stay the F away from tankies. Make sure if you know, that's a line he's been told not to cross. He's terrified of me. He's absolutely terrified. He knows that he's been given a task. He has a job, and it's a good job. Fighting the alt-right, great. Giving people basic class consciousness, great. But smearing existing socialism, smearing the history of the Communist Party, smearing China, trying to equate those who defend existing socialism with Nazis, that's not okay in my view, and I will push back against that. And it seems like, you know, that he's been oriented to stay away from me. If that's the case, but he shouldn't present it as some kind of bold move. He shouldn't present it as if that's somehow honorable. He should present it as opportunism, because that's what it is. And the fact that he not only will debate right wingers, but we now see him almost, you know, almost begging this Sticks and Hammer, this right wing guy, almost begging him, like practically offering to pay him to debate him. But yet he won't debate another leftist with whom he disagrees about the USSR and China. That shows you what he's about, and the vulgar language toward tankies and all of that. I can guarantee you that there's more to this than just Vosh's personal views. I think that this is exposing what Vosh is about and who may have enabled Vosh to suddenly become the voice of Marxism. You wouldn't believe, when I was tweeting at Vosh, I listed famous people who supported the Soviet Union, like Nelson Mandela, who was a big supporter of the Soviet Union, big supporter of Fidel Castro, big admirer of Gaddafi. And I got his fans tweeting at me that I must be retarded because, no, none of those people, Nelson Mandela, would never support the Soviet Union. Well, Nelson Mandela, we now learned after his death, was on the Central Committee of the South African Communist Party. The ANC was bankrolled by the Soviet Union, while the U.S. government called it a terrorist organization. So that's how ignorant his fans are. And that's how much damage he is doing by putting that out there, by putting out socialism laced in anti-communism. He's doing something very, very problematic, and he should be opposed.
Yeah, you mentioned there that you may have scared off Destiny a little bit with some of your points, and it's kind of funny because I was recently watching a Vosh video, something I don't normally do, but I saw on the side of his YouTube screen that he was watching your debate with Destiny, and he made it about halfway through. So maybe your points scared him away there a little bit, but...
Indeed. Well, let me add one thing, which is I've noticed this. And I don't want to say this in a way that we should be upset about this. We should be happy about this in a way. But if you'll notice, like, the person who set up the debate between me and Destiny is this guy named Faraday Speaks. He's Caleb something. He's also named Caleb, same name as me. But he was featured in the New York Times. He was an ex-alt-rightist who is now left-wing or something like that. He's the one who set up the debate between me and Destiny. He was featured in the New York Times. There's also ContraPoints, which is a YouTube channel that I actually have learned a lot from. You know, I don't agree with everything on it, but I've learned a lot from ContraPoints, who calls herself kind of a socialist. And she talks about internet memes and the alt-right and stuff like that. Now we have Vosh. And it seems like there is some funding and that there is some entity that is kind of strategically highlighting these kind of voices as an effort to beat back the alt-right. That's probably a good thing, right? I mean, not probably, it is a good thing. But I think that that entity is also very, very anti-socialist, against China, against the Soviet Union, maybe, and weird, you know, maybe more sympathetic to Vietnam, which is interesting, maybe more sympathetic to Cuba, but very hostile to Russia and China, very hostile to the history of the Soviet Union and such. And that it seems like that entity is kind of, you know, whatever that entity is, could be a private foundation, could be one wealthy individual, who knows? But it seems like certain voices that all kind of have the same kind of perspective are suddenly out of the blue appearing on social media and becoming the voices of leftism. And mainstream media highlights them, right? I mean, we saw the New Yorker highlighted ContraPoints, and mainstream media kind of also props them up. And it's very interesting. And I wonder who's behind this, who's paying for this. And I think it's interesting. And it kind of points to fights within the bourgeoisie that I talked about, you know, earlier, right? And that they're, you know, the alt-right is definitely a threat. And I'm sure there's many sections of the bourgeoisie that are supporting the alt-right. So this is an interesting development that we as Marxists should analyze.
Yeah, and I'm glad you're, you know, taking the time to keep up with all this stuff, because this is something, like, just being on the YouTube left, a lot of us have been talking about for a while, but it's very interesting to see that it's even come back to you and now you're dealing with this. But I believe we have two more questions here. I'm going to ask a question for Danky. He was going to ask this, but he was going to ask about our party, the PCUSA. I'm not sure how much you've heard of our party or anything, but, you know, we're relatively small. We've been around for 5 years or so. We're still building up. Mm-hmm. But, you know, this movement, it's known for, you know, a lot of sectarianism, stuff like that. So what advice would you have for, like, a party that wants to hopefully become the vanguard party one day? What would you say is a good way to carry yourself and such?
Oh, well, you know, I know Angelo D'Angelo. He's a
great,
very friendly guy. I've learned a lot from him. I know at one point the PCUSA was publishing a lot of really good books with Red Star Publishers, and I actually would buy a lot of those books. And I have many of those books on my bookshelf right now. So, you know, I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of great folks like yourselves in PCUSA. And, you know, my advice would be, you know, the main thing is to not be afraid to question old ideas, not be afraid to apply things in a new way, and always be aiming for the masses, not the movement. And, you know, right now I'm in the process of establishing a think tank, not a new party, not a new party, but a think tank. Because I think that, you know, really, you know, with all due respect, you know, to your organization and many others, I don't think there's really any organization in the United States that can actually call itself a vanguard party at this time. We have a lot of, you know, different pre-party formations. We have the remnants of what were vanguard parties or mass parties at one point. But I don't think there's really any group that really represents the broad masses of the American people at this point. And, you know, my hope is that with this think tank, we can start to carry out that ideological work I've been talking about. One thing I've often highlighted is, you know, I live in New York City. Many times I've gotten a knock on my door from a Jehovah's Witness or from a Mormon to tell me about their viewpoint. We need it so not just in New York City, but in, you know, Kansas and Iowa and Wisconsin and Texas and Mississippi and Hawaii. People are knocking on people's doors to tell them about socialism with literature that explains it in very, very clear ways. And we need people that are looking for answers to start becoming socialists. You know, we do want to affect the overwhelming majority of people, but I think right now, you know, most people in the United States, you know, are not recruitable to hard ideological socialism at this point. But I feel like there's probably 1 in 10 people who's looking for something, right? They don't know what they're looking for. But 1 in 10 people are looking for something. And those are the people we need to get to. And we need to show them that socialism is what they're looking for. And the question is, how do we find those people? If you started knocking on doors, you could expect 9 out of 10 people would shut the door in your face, not interested. But there's 1 out of 10 people who's looking for something. And I think a lot of the people that are looking for something are young people who are discovering they don't have a role in the economy like their parents once did. They're going to have a life of low-wage, short-term service sector jobs. They're looking for something. They don't have peace with this society. Their mind is open, and we need to get to those people and show them socialism and Marxism-Leninism and the history of our movement and point them toward building something new. You know, we need to start building, and that's my hope, you know, I hope with this pandemic, but we need to start building mass socialist meetings with music and great speeches where people can feel empowered. We need to start printing socialist literature. We need to have socialist choirs and socialist marching bands and socialist open mic nights in neighborhoods. We need to have socialist food banks that are feeding hungry people. We need to build an apparatus of socialism, a socialist community in the United States, not just people talking online, but an actual socialist community where people can feel at home, where people can feel a part of it, where it becomes part of their life. I almost tell people we need to be the new secular religion. The way people that are in a church, they go to a church every Sunday, they hear some speeches, that's their social circle, it's people they know. We need socialism to start to be that kind of role in people's lives in working class neighborhoods and communities. And I don't know if a party is necessarily the best way to create that. I hope that eventually that would give birth to a party, maybe an electoral party, maybe a vanguard party. But maybe, you know, at this point, I'm aiming to set up this think tank, the Center for Political Innovation. But I hope that it can get to be something far, far beyond that.
Absolutely. I think that's a great point. We need to start building real life communities for sure. And kind of building off what you were talking about a little bit earlier, where you're talking about Red Star Publishers. So actually, PCUSA has actually shifted their publishing division to something called New Outlook Publishers, where we're actually uploading books that we've gotten from the Red Star archives pretty much constantly, adding new titles to there. And we're actually selling the books at cost. So they're at the absolute minimum price that they can possibly be. So definitely go check that out. If you were a fan of Red Star, definitely go check that out. I urge everybody. But on the topic of books, this is going to be the final question for tonight, for today. We were wondering, so I mean, when we're talking about leftism, we're talking about socialism, people are always recommending like the classic books to read. You know, you have like State and Revolution, you have Das Kapital, you have Socialism, Utopian Scientific, you know, books that are just foundational that everybody should read. But the thing about these is maybe the limitation of these books is that they tend to be older. They tend to be from probably the turn of the 20th century or the late 1800s. And it can be very hard and inaccessible for people to relate these ideas to the modern day and what socialism means today. And so we were wondering if you had any sort of book recommendations dealing with socialism as it exists in the world right now. And helping new leftists, especially in an accessible way, kind of getting their foot in the door and kind of maybe understanding how to make sense of the world today from a principled socialist perspective.
Wow. Well, I guess the first thing is that when you talk about those books that people read, like What Is to Be Done and The State and Revolution, and I mean, those books are very important. Don't get me wrong. But I recall when I was a teenager, when I was reading this stuff for the first time, I felt like so much of what I was doing was decoding. You know what I'm saying? I was decoding, you know, because it was like, it was almost, this stuff was almost written in a foreign language, you know, and it was like, it was so new to me and it was so difficult to comprehend, right? And that what I discovered as a teenager that really pointed me in the direction that I am now was the Communist Party USA's literature from the 1930s. I read Towards Soviet America by William Z. Foster. That book is very clearly written. It was the Communist Party USA's, you know, book for the 1932 elections. Very clear language. It explained their perspective, it explained Marxist concepts very clearly, very concisely. And I learned so much from reading that book. And I really love, if you read, you know, the pamphlets of Earl Browder, there's a great pamphlet called Why Communism by Moishe Olgin. You know, I mean, if you read these kind of pamphlets, why you should be a socialist, what the Communist Party is and what it stands for, you know, I mean, these are really good pamphlets that give you a very basic introduction to these ideas and do so in a very, very clear, straightforward way. We can't expect people to decode all this stuff. People like you and I are going to do it. I've read those classics. So have you. But most people that are just getting into this and just kind of giving it a chance, if you hand them one of those things, they're going to go, yeah, okay, well, I'm going to move on. I'm going to find something that's a little more coherent. But in terms of right now, the problem is those are all very, very old pamphlets, right? In terms of right now, I wrote a book called City Builders and Vandals in Our Age, which is very popular. great reviews. Many copies have been sold. Hundreds of copies of it have sold. And what people praise it for is the fact that it's written so clearly. You know, and that's why I wrote it, because I think we need clearly written literature. When I was in one of the socialist groups I was in, they actively worked to prevent me from publishing this kind of material. You know, I mean, they felt like only their leading comrades, they called them, could publish this kind of stuff. And I had to fight very hard to publish the little bit that I did. And even if I let them edit it and change everything, that still wasn't enough. No, it has to be written by our leading comrades. And they were old and didn't feel like doing it. And they had no literature. And like during Occupy Wall Street, it was a big problem that, you know, people would come up to our literature table and we had pamphlets about, you know, the Carter administration to sell them. You know, it was pretty ridiculous, but that's how the group was. It was kind of the ego trip of some old, you know, baby boomer new leftists. And, you know, they got jealous of anyone else who came along and wrote something or spoke better than they could or whatever. And that's a big problem. And a lot of leftist groups are like that. And that democratic centralism, you know, democratic centralism, when Lenin applied it, what it meant was it was a way that he could get the greatest, smartest, most dynamic revolutionary organizers in Russia to coordinate their actions. The idea was, you were all dynamic, you're all brilliant, so we're going to get together and we're going to debate and we're going to decide what our position is. And then after that, we're all going to be obligated to carry it out. We're going to keep our fights internal, right? Inside the group, not public. And that's what democratic centralism was. And the idea was that it was a way to have so many strong personalities in one group, right? Well, what democratic centralism has become is the opposite. The reason there's a million parties in the United States is because every group has one dynamic personality. And if another dynamic personality or another, you know, effective speaker or organizer or writer comes along, they have to form their own group, because democratic centralism kind of means that every group becomes kind of a little cult around one person. You know, and that's a problem. And if you look at the remaining groups, I don't know much about PCUSA. I'm not saying that about your group at all. But I, you know, if you look at the remaining groups in the United States, you know, the RCP and the WWP and different groups, you know, all these Trotskyist groups, they're all kind of one or two people's little ego trip. And the reason that they've split a million times is because somebody else comes along who's dynamic and, oh, we can't have that. There's this feeling that leftist groups are kind of a platform for one person. And if, you know, if someone has to share the stage, they need to form a new group. That's a big problem. That is a very, very big problem, but it speaks to the fact that we're not really organizing. You know, when Lenin built the Bolsheviks, he went to all the great revolutionaries in Russia and tried to get them all in the same group. He didn't split the groups, and the Bolsheviks were not a cult around Lenin. The cult of Lenin was formed after the death of Lenin because, you know, for reasons, when Stalin was trying to organize the USSR, and, you know, and kind of centralize it and have kind of an ideological figure, it was built for that reason. But at the time the Bolsheviks were formed, it was very much a place where all kinds of brilliant organizers and thinkers were able to flourish. And that's ultimately what will happen. When we start to move in a revolutionary direction in the United States, we're going to have parties that will have all kinds of dynamic leaders. In Venezuela, you know, when Chavez, you know, created the United Socialist Party and called for different communist groups in Venezuela to merge into it, he formed the PSUV, the United Socialist Party of Venezuela, and there are all kinds of dynamic organizers and leaders in it, Trotskyists, Maoists, Stalinists, what else? Anarchists, Christian socialist ministers and priests. I mean, the PSUV is a really broad tent because they're actually trying to get something done. So when we're starting to move in a revolutionary direction, we'll see groups merging with each other, not splitting. But right now, because it's kind of an ego trip for some people, we're seeing groups splitting, not merging. So I think this will change over time. I hope that answers your question. I guess I kind of lost track.
Yeah, absolutely. So I absolutely agree. I think probably the split in the left right now is probably just a result of the conditions that we're under. But once things tend to accelerate, I think we see this in the past. We tend to see that even in the Bolshevik, socialist revolution in Russia, there were a whole bunch of little parties, but then conditions changed, and then it necessitated them to all kind of put aside their differences, merge together, and form kind of a united front. So, essentially, we just basically need to kind of shift the conversation and in preparation for a situation like that to come about. I don't think it's necessarily the fault of any one party or anything like that. Definitely just a material perspective on that. One other thing I was just wondering was just, for new communists, new socialists, new leftists, to understand modern socialist countries. So I know you talk about China a lot. You talk about Vietnam, Cuba a lot. Do you have any book recommendations for people who might be confused by these current states to maybe be able to understand them a little bit better and their conditions?
Sure. I mean, there's a great book called When China Rules the World. It's written by someone who writes for the Communist Party newspaper in the United Kingdom. It's very good. There's also a lot of books written in China that you can get in English, like China, the Rise of a Civilization State. There's a great document from Vietnam by the Secretary General of the Vietnamese Communist Party that is very, very good, that explains the socialist-oriented market economy of Vietnam. But the main thing I would encourage, you know, folks to do, and maybe people don't have the ability to do it, but it's one thing you should really consider doing is traveling. If you're a communist, go to international communist gatherings. You know, the World Festival of Youth and Students happens every 4 years. I've been to two of them now. The most educational experiences of my life. You know, I never have learned more than I learned in Quito, Ecuador in 2013 and Sochi, Russia in 2017. I don't know where the next one's going to be. And I might be too old. I may not be a youth anymore, but there were a lot of older folks at that last one. So maybe they'll let me go to the next one. I don't know where it's going to be. But, you know, go to international communist gatherings, go to Venezuela, go to Cuba, go to China, go to Vietnam. I would really recommend people do that because you have to kind of see it for yourself. Mao Zedong said, the only way to know what a pear tastes like is to bite into it. And in a lot of ways, you have to do it for yourself. And that a lot of the most dynamic literature about socialism is not being written in English right now. It's being written in Spanish. It's being written in Chinese. And in a lot of cases, these socialist countries actually don't want a lot of it written in English because they're trying to trade with American companies. They want American companies to do business. So if they seem like they're, you know, radical, extreme communists, they're not going to get the foreign investment they want. So some of the more revolutionary literature that they write is purposely not translated into the English language. So you got to see it for yourself and you got to meet revolutionaries. I love this YouTube channel by the young woman from Vietnam, Luna. Oh, no. I mean, it's a great channel. There's a lot coming out. You know, the Chinese have published Xi Jinping's writings on socialism with Chinese characteristics. That's great stuff. And there's a lot being published now. There's a lot of think tanks around the world promoting socialism. There's a lot coming out of Venezuela and the Bolivarian countries. There's a lot of professors and writers in Venezuela, in Ecuador, in South America that have been very key in crafting Bolivarian policy that are very, very interesting and worth studying. There's a lot being published right now that you can read.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I'll definitely have to check those out. Well, we're about to wrap it up here, but I wanted to just get a quick word from you on the Center for Political Innovation. Yeah. I was actually trying to get some of our comrades in the party to come visit, like when you were originally planning this. And luckily, I called it early. I almost bought like a plane ticket and stuff. I was like, I don't know, this coronavirus may pick up. And unfortunately, it did. But I definitely look forward to next year. But yeah, did you want to give any quick word on what the Center for Political Innovation is?
Yeah, well, it's a think tank that we're establishing for the purpose of raising educational awareness about socialism and spreading socialist ideas and anti-imperialism. We don't know when the launch conference is going to be, but when this pandemic is over, when we can set a date and start building, please come. I mean, there's going to be our down payment has already been accepted by the hotel. They'll accept it for whatever the new date is. So it should be good when we have it. It's going to be at a very nice hotel, and it's going to be a lot of really good speakers have confirmed, and it's going to be a great event. So I hope that folks will get involved. There's no bar. I mean, if you're a member of the PCUSA, you're welcome. You know, if you're a member of the PSL, you're a member of no socialist group, you're in the DSA. A lot of people in DSA are helping plan the conference already. A lot of people in the CPUSA are also helping plan the conference already. There's people that are in no socialist group. There's anarchists that are involved. We want to make it a great conference, and we want to facilitate an organization that is massive, right? That goes around the country putting on socialist events. We're going to have a West Coast launch conference as well. We're going to have one in Los Angeles and one in New York City. So we'll open on both coasts. We're planning to have kind of a weekend of events in Boston at one point. We have two spaces that will host us to have pretty good events in Boston. And Providence, Rhode Island. And we want to, you know, do some incursions into the Midwest and into the South. So we're looking to expand. I mean, we need a mass socialist awakening in the United States. You know, I always tell people the American Revolution, where we won our independence from the British, was preceded by the Great Awakening, when there was an awakening of religious consciousness in the USA. The Civil War, which was the fight against slavery, was preceded by the Second Great Awakening. And actually, my ancestor, Charles G. Finney, was an essential part of that. He was a pastor in New York City who moved to Ohio and helped set up Oberlin College, and he was very opposed to slavery. But that was at a time where politics in the United States manifested itself mainly in terms of religion. That's kind of where the public was at. But if you look at the 1960s and the political movements of the 1960s, they were preceded by kind of an awakening, right? In the early 60s, you saw a political awakening among the public with Kennedy and all of that. And I feel like before we can have, you know, revolutionary upheaval and you know, movement towards socialism in the United States, we're going to have a kind of society-wide spiritual, cultural, political awakening. And I hope that the Center for Political Innovation can help carry that out to change the consciousness and set the stage for the activism that is to come.
That's fantastic. Yeah, I mean, as unfortunate as the pandemic was, I'm a little bit glad that it got delayed so that I had an opportunity to learn about it. And hopefully we'll be able to go check it out as soon as it becomes available. We'll definitely be in contact about that and kind of let people know when that's going to be hosted. Yeah, so I think we're going to be wrapping it up. But before we let you go, where can listeners find you online? Where can they talk with you? And yeah, any other places that you want to plug or any books you want to plug?
Well, I'm at CalebMaupin.com, CalebMaupin. You can check out my YouTube channel. I'm the author of City Builders and Vandals in Our Age. I've written a book on the history of the Communist Party. I've written some other books as well, Getting Rich Without Capitalism, et cetera. But yeah, you know, and I want to congratulate you all for the great work that you're doing, setting up a YouTube channel, debating these people on these left-wing streams, you know, putting out socialist ideas, working against the grain, against the current. You guys are doing a great job. Thanks for having me on. This was a great conversation. And I look forward to future collaboration in all of our efforts to change society and move the United States towards socialism.
Absolutely. It was wonderful having you on. And yeah, thank you so much for coming on and being our first guest on the show. We really appreciate it.
Sure thing. Good luck.
Yeah, thanks so much.
All right. Thank you so much. Have a good night.
You too.
Bye.